Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. My goal in this short video is to quickly cover the roots of the current unfortunate conflict, with emphasis on the period from the middle of the 19th century to the armistice of 1949. There's a lot of material on this crucial period that occupies much of the world's attention right now and really for the last century. Much of the material online is unfortunately highly tendentious and very misleading. I'm going to be relying very heavily on the research of Professor Gudrun Kramer from the Free University of Berlin, who wrote a very serviceable one-volume history. She has made a very good case for the fact that most historians come to this topic with a great degree of tunnel vision and tend to see the entire history from within the perspective of their own national, religious, ethnic backgrounds. And I'm going to do my best to try and rise above that. Obviously, I have my own biases and my own opinions like everybody else, but let's try and go over the facts in as dispassionate a manner as possible, and then I can leave it up to you to debate what it means for our current moment. So let's start with a discussion of terminology, because as Professor Kramer rightly points out, there is power in naming things. And so my intention here is just to achieve clarity, even though some anachronisms may result. And I apologize for those of you who are deeply steeped in this history, this will be somewhat basic. But let's just make sure we're all on the same page with this. First of all, the term Palestinian. So Palestine is the name that was given to this region of the world. In the next section, I'm going to take you through some maps to say, well, which region exactly. It is a term that derives originally from a Roman adaptation in the second century, after having dealt with three revolts of the Jewish population. They decided to completely wipe out the name Judea, which was the Jewish name of the southern part of what would be the land of Israel today, and they renamed the entire section Palestina. So that term entered into Western usage already from the second century and was later adapted, for example, in the Arab world as Philistine. Now, Palestinian was also used in the 20th century and in the 19th century as well to refer to Jews who lived in this region as well, who would call themselves Palestinian Jews. I know that sounds strange today, but for example, look at this newspaper, the Palestine Post, which is actually a Jewish newspaper. Its name was later changed to the Jerusalem Post, but that's just because the term did not have the strong ethnic and national connotations that it has today. So that's Palestinian. Israeli. Israeli refers to people who have citizenship in the state of Israel, and approximately 20% of the people who have citizenship in the state of Israel would call themselves Palestinian. This is just an indication of how confusing it is. Israeli citizenship is extended to a large number of Arabs, Druze, Christians, Baha'i, and other peoples who are not Jewish. So Israeli refers to a citizenship in the state of Israel. What about the term Arab? So Arab is an ethnic term that refers to a large number of people all across the entire Middle East. It includes Palestinians, but it does not include Muslims. Muslim is an even larger term. It is a religious term referring to people who worship according to the dictates of Islam, and that includes all kinds of people in the Far East, for example, or in Africa, and of course in the United States not. The term Jew is also, it's a religious term, but it's also an ethnic term, because many people who are Jews do not consider themselves religious. But nevertheless, they still fall within this ethnic definition. And as I mentioned, about 80% of Israelis are also Jewish, but about half of the world's Jews are not Israelis. Israel houses about half of the entire population of the world's Jews, in other words. Finally, Zionist. So Zionist, the term Zionism was coined in the late 19th century to describe this movement towards reestablishing a Jewish homeland in the land which we're going to call Palestine. This is an aspiration that does not necessarily mean it has to come to fruition in actual Israeli statehood. It can also be understood as support for the land of Israel. And once again, The majority of Jews clearly are Zionist and support the state of Israel to one degree or another, but there are many Jews who are not Zionists. There are even some Israelis who are not Zionist, believe it or not. That's because Israel is a democratic country that tolerates a very wide range of difference of opinion on a whole host of political, social, economic, and other issues. So that's our basic survey of terminology. Let's look at the maps a little bit. Where exactly is Palestine? The borders of the region, which has been called Palestine, vary significantly over the space of the last two millennia. There has never been a state of Palestine, that is true, but the region has had that term already, as we see, from the second century. It is especially well used after the seventh century when it becomes an Islamic land, and in the region of the Ottoman Empire, which ruled for almost exactly 500 years until the beginning of the 20th century, it was actually divided between two administrative sections, that of Jerusalem and that of Beirut. So the regional identity of Palestine, or in Arabic, Filastin, was not very well developed really until the 20th century. It nevertheless did have consciousness. You see from this newspaper, Filastin, which was actually established in 1909, very early on in this period. But for many, the term Palestine geographically is identical to the boundaries of the state of Israel, which in itself is a huge problem. As you see in this depiction here, Filastin, which has the slogan Min il Nahar il il Bahar, from the river to the sea, the river being the Jordan River on the west and the Mediterranean Sea on the east, by saying Min il Nahar il il Bahar, you're saying essentially, at least this is how Jews hear it, that there's no space for Israel. There's only space for Palestine. In other words, Palestine will be free, meaning free of Jews, Judenrein, which is why many Jews find this deeply offensive. So in other words, the boundaries of Palestine, as understood by many Palestinian supporters today, are virtually identical to the boundaries of modern Israel shown here. In the next video in this plan series, I'll explain what are the differences between Israel proper, Gaza, the West Bank, and the Golan Heights. But for now, this is basically the territory that we're going to be speaking about over the course of this video. At the risk of horrible oversimplification, Jewish claims at their root are based in the idea that this is the ancient homeland of the Jews, and Palestinian claims are based on the notion that they conquered the land in the 7th century with the advent of Islam, and that makes them essentially indigenous because they have been living in that region for some 1,300 years. This is a little bit like something I saw with two of my grandchildren the other day. I don't mean to reduce these complex and painful issues to something very juvenile, but this will at least help as a metaphor. Two of my grandchildren have a favorite chair, which was given to them by the other set of grandparents, and it actually has the name of the older child written on it. So the younger child was sitting on it, and the older child wanted to take it from the younger child, and we said, no, you have to let her sit there. But then she saw something that distracted her. She got up from the chair and she went off to do something else. And in that time, the older child went and sat in the chair, which upset the younger child seeing that she was in there. And that involved a whole bunch of fighting. But basically, that's the same kind of claim. I was here first versus you left and then I took it. The fact that the name is written on the chair does not necessarily feed into whose chair it is forever and ever, because, to extend this back to our situation, the main source of the claim, the deed, as it were, for the land of Israel, for Jews, is the Bible, and Muslims do not regard the Bible, the Hebrew scriptures, and for that matter, the Christian scriptures, as being duly sanctified the same way that Jews and Christians do. So the deed is not relevant here. It's true that there's multiple points to demonstrate that Jews were in the land of Israel from ancient times. The oldest non-biblical example is the famous Merneptah stele shown here, which dates from about the year 1209 BCE and refers to a people called Israel living here. But the counter argument that when the Muslims conquered in the 7th century, as you see in this map, is also a very strong one. And in the absence of divine intervention, which I'm sure both sides would like to appeal to, there's no easy way to reconcile these claims. So let's move to the Ottoman period, and specifically to the area we'd like to concentrate, the 19th century, to understand how this conflict expressed itself. The metaphor of my grandchildren in the chair is not entirely accurate for a lot of reasons, one of which is that there was always a small presence of Jews in the land of Israel, as best we can tell from historical records. Having a look at the very weak statistics from the Ottoman Empire, it wasn't until the latter part of the 19th century that they started to provide more, reliable statistics, but this gives us at least some sense of it. In 1850, looking at Ottoman subjects only, not foreign people living in this land, Muslims and Druze who were included in this survey amounted to about 88% of the population, Christians about 8%, and Jews about 4%. But by the time you move to the later part of the 19th century, there is a significant shift in Jewish attitudes, and many Jews, really absorbing the national movements that are rocking much of Europe at the time, Eastern Europe in particular, they begin to explore the idea of developing a Jewish nationalism with the object of creating a Jewish national state in this part of the world as well. The most famous early movement is called Bilu, taken from this verse in the Bible, Beit Yaakov, Lechu v'Nelcha, House of Jacob, let us arise and go, meaning go to the land of Israel and colonize it there in order to establish a Jewish settlement back in the ancient homeland. And in fact, they did, working the land with some success, but they were heavily supported by Jews around the world. The idea of Zionism, especially promoted by Theodor Herzl, really caught the imagination of Jews living around the world saying, yes, of course, this is a fantastic idea. And although most Jews were not specifically willing to pick themselves up and move to Israel, they were overwhelmingly very happy to support the movement, especially financially. You can see in this poster here, these are some English language posters, help him build Palestine. Once again, it's clearly a Jewish poster. At the bottom, it's written in Yiddish, helft im boyen Eretz Yisrael, help him build the land of Israel. This was the kind of fundraising poster that was used by the Jewish National Fund, established specifically to buy lands in Palestine, which they bought legally throughout this entire period. Here's another one that gives you a sense of the kind of modern feeling of it. A nation reborn on its ancestral soil. It really appeals to the imagination. It's young, it's powerful, has kind of like a socialist vibe to it. And in fact, the early settlements did have very strong socialist leanings and so on. So basically, as you move through the early 20th century, the population of Jews in the region increases dramatically. Looking at this chart of statistics, which was taken by the British, much more accurate and reasonable than the Ottoman figures, you can see that in 1922, the blue column are Jews. Of course, the green column are the Muslims. There's also Christians. And then here we've broken out the Druze, the Baha'i, and many other peoples living in the land. By 1931, there has been a natural increase of Muslims, both through birth rate, but also through immigration. And the Jewish increase has also been marked. By 1946 is even more dramatic. And in fact, this is one of the arguments that needs to be teased out is how many of the Arabs who moved to this region were in fact from other parts of the Arabic world and later adopted a Palestinian identity. It's something that the historical literature discusses at some length. Now, basically, what happens is the Ottoman Empire absorbs these Jewish immigrants with a certain amount of tension. They are buying the land legally from Arab notables living in the region. There's a certain amount of competition with the local Arab workforce and a certain amount of hesitancy to admit people who are definitely trying to build a new nation state in this region. there's also a Kulturkampf, a culture struggle between the highly conservative Muslims living in the region and these European modern Jewish immigrants who are, you know, having women dress differently, educated very differently, engage in different kinds of cultural activities, which many of the Muslims find shocking and different and so on. Is in the context of World War I, the Ottoman Empire disappears, and the British and the French engage in very large geopolitical discussions to essentially divide up the region between them. The way this plays out specifically for the region we're talking about is especially represented in this document here, written by the Foreign Secretary Lord Balfour. This is the so-called Balfour Declaration, in which he writes this message to Lord Rothschild and asks him to send it to the Zionist Federation. And look at the inside paragraph there, which really encapsulates the problem that the British would have for the next 50-odd years. His Majesty's government view with favor the establishment in Palestine of a national home for the Jewish people and will use their best endeavors to facilitate the achievement of this object. That's at the point where most Jews just stopped reading, and it was a big party for them because it looked like England, which was in fact very soon going to take over this region with the collapse of the Ottoman Empire, England was going to give Palestine to the Jews. But the second part of the paragraph reads, "It being clearly understood that nothing shall be done which may prejudice the civil and religious rights of existing non-Jewish communities in Palestine or the rights and political status enjoyed by Jews in any other country." Meaning the British were saying essentially two things at the same time. On the one hand, they're going to give some of this land to the Jews for their Jewish homeland. But at the same time, they're saying as long as the Arab peoples living there do not object. And that's basically going to be impossible. It's also going to be something which will definitely affect the Jews living in any other country as well, as we shall see. Jews celebrate this with great excitement, and Arabs are concerned. They're not using the term Palestinians for themselves, but as I mentioned in the prelude, let's just refer to them as Palestinians. That term will become much more popular when we get to the second half of the 20th century. The first series of disturbances were associated with the Nabi Musa festival, which ironically commemorates the life of Moses, held sacred by both Jews, Christians, and Muslims. And in the context of this initial riot, 5 Jews and 4 Arabs were killed, and 230 people, primarily Jews in this case, were injured. And this kicks off a series of riots and retaliations. Arab riots against Jews, and occasionally Jewish riots against Arabs as well, that go throughout the 1930s, culminating in a major period between 1936 and 1939 of very, very heavy violence. I will allow other historians to work out, you know, which acts of violence were more significant, but there's no question that what people refer to as the cycle of violence really begins in 1920, right after the Balfour Declaration. So the British, right away, they're very good at establishing commissions, and they establish a new commission under Earl Peel, and he issues a massive document called the Peel Report. And very rarely has anyone said it as well as this particular report does. I'll just read to you one section. This is from chapter 20, which could basically say the same thing about much of the later part of the century as well. "The problem of Palestine is briefly restated. Under the stress of the World War," this is of course World War I, "the British government made promises to Arabs and Jews in order to obtain their support. On the strength of those promises, both parties formed certain expectations. The application to Palestine of the mandate system in general, and of the specific mandate in particular, implies the belief that the obligations thus undertaken towards the Arabs and the Jews respectively would prove in course of time to be mutually compatible owing to the conciliatory effect on the Palestinian Arabs of the material prosperity which Jewish immigration would bring in Palestine as a whole. That belief has not been justified, and there seems to be no hope of its being justified in the future." In other words, the British said that they were hoping that, you know, by having Jews move in and improve the economy. And the Peel Report actually discusses that, yeah, Jewish immigration did help the economy significantly. There was a lot more employment. There was a lot more capital flowing and a lot more foreign investment. But that prosperity would not help to solve the political dispute between the Arabs and the Jews in this region. Let's go back. But the British people cannot, on that account, repudiate their obligations, and apart from obligations, the existing circumstances in Palestine would still require the most strenuous efforts on the part of the government, which is responsible for the welfare of the country. The existing circumstances are summarized as follows. An irrepressible conflict has arisen between two national communities within the narrow bounds of one small country. There is no common ground between them. Their national aspirations are incompatible. The Arabs desire to revive the traditions of the Arab Golden Age. The Jews desire to show what they can achieve when restored to the land in which the Jewish nation was born. Neither of the two national ideals permits of combination in the service of a single state. This may be the genesis of what was called the two-state solution, which was eagerly pursued by many diplomatic efforts in the second half of the 20th century. God willing, we'll get to that in another lecture. The Peel Report had an appendix which laid out a map, a very controversial map here, that said we should partition this region. And the area outlined in red was to be given to the Jews as a homeland. As you can see, it's a tiny fraction of the later boundaries of the land of Israel, and not entirely conforming to the way that the populations had spread out through the land. A lot of Arabs were in this region, a lot of Jews were outside this region, and Jews were incensed that this is what Peel was suggesting. And there's also that kind of like it looks like a word bubble extending from the ocean to Jerusalem. That's supposed to be like an international zone allowing for access to the holy sites in Jerusalem for everybody. And the rest of the region outside of that red line would be an Arab country, presumably attached to what was called Transjordan. Transjordan was actually separated from the British mandate applied to Palestine earlier. So the Jews were incensed. The Arabs were not satisfied, and this came to naught. The period of 1936 to 1939 saw extensive dissatisfaction with the British mandate and the mandate authorities. Arab uprisings, Jewish violence against each other and against the British were pursued throughout this period. The British attempted under Colonial Secretary Malcolm MacDonald to look at the problem again, once the British again are very good at establishing commissions, and he wrote up a white paper that suggested perhaps they should limit Jewish immigration to the land to 75,000 people over 5 years, which was guaranteed to blow the lid off Jewish aspirations, because look at the time we're talking about. It's the late 1930s. Anti-Semitism is ramping up in Europe under Hitler. And of course, World War II would begin in 1939, just a few months after the white paper came out, and immigration of Jews anywhere was a top concern for the entire Jewish people, because of course Hitler would take 6 million lives over the course of World War II. After the Holocaust, you have millions of displaced people all over Europe. Hundreds of thousands of Jews in particular are unwilling or unable to return to their homes in Poland, and they're seeking to establish themselves in the ancestral homeland of Israel. Legal migration and illegal migration is happening at a tremendous clip, and the British are desperate to try and hold off these thousands of Jews who are seeking to make their way to safety in the Middle East. The Arabs, of course, are very incensed with the idea that Europe's problems should be solved with migration to the Middle East, but as one Zionist from the era put it, the Arabs have a problem of appetite and the Jews have a problem of starvation. They needed someplace else to live and no other place was acceptable. So basically the British gave up. Very similar to how they dealt with their departure from India. You know, the entire geopolitical world had changed. They had to retrench themselves after World War II, and they handed the problem off to the United Nations. The United Nations came up with this resolution, number 181, which essentially said the land should be partitioned into seven sections. And here's a map, which was attached to the bottom of resolution 181, that divides the land of Israel quite differently from the Peel report. The green areas were to be Jewish. There are three of them connected by tiny little wastes. And the goldenrod areas are to be Arab, also connected by these little wastes. And a seventh section was to be around the area of Jerusalem, and that was supposed to be, like the Peel report, some kind of international zone. The history after this point is well known. The Jews, now Israelis, accepted the plan, and in 1948 they proclaimed statehood, and they were immediately attacked by Arab armies surrounding them. They fought a very, very difficult war, but ended up managing to not only keep this territory, but in fact expand it somewhat. That's a very important part of this whole history, but we should understand that the conflict with the Palestinians really began even before that war happened. As soon as Resolution 181 was passed and before the British could leave, there was already violence erupting between Jews and Arabs. And a large number of Arabs living in Palestine chose to flee. Somewhere in the range of 700,000 Arabs left their homes seeking safety. Now, one of the larger debates, like we mentioned earlier with the cycle of violence, one of the larger debates focuses on the question of why exactly did they leave. It does not take a tremendous amount of imagination to realize that, you know, families flee theaters of war. There were examples of atrocities, and even an atrocity that is exaggerated and spread through the rumor mill is something that will strike fear in the heart of a family and would cause them to flee. Once again, I defer to other historians to go through the details. I'm sure you will find it useful to look at Professor Kramer's work to go into more details as to what specific events Deir Yassin and others that prompted many of these people to flee. But this was called the Nakba, the catastrophe, which essentially displaced something like 750,000 people from what would become the state of Israel in the armistice of 1949. If you look at this map here, you can see the green areas were assigned to the state of Israel in the 1947 partition plan. But after successfully defending the territory, the Israelis were able to actually add those pink areas to make the boundaries somewhat more defensible than they were before. That's essentially the origins of the Palestinian Nakba. It's also important to note that there is a Jewish version of this Nakba at the same time. Shortly after this war, there was a wave of anti-Jewish persecution throughout the Islamic world, particularly in Arab lands, and Jews were forced to flee from many of these countries. Perhaps 800,000 Jews were required to flee, many of them making their way to Israel, which ironically achieved the opposite purpose of what many of these states might have had in mind, because it made Israel much more stable and stronger demographically and further cemented its presence in the Middle East. So that's a very quick overview of the major events that contribute to the conflict between Israelis and Palestinians. I'm sure that many of you will comment that I forgot to mention this or forgot to mention that. And it's true, it's inevitable that as I attempt to compress this massive history into a very, very short presentation, it's inevitable to omit certain things. But I hope that this overview does something to break down the tunnel vision that's so prevalent on social media today, and people can have hopefully productive discussions about how this conflict may be resolved peaceably, and that all the peoples in the land should enjoy health and prosperity. Thank you very much for watching.